Good morning, everyone. Welcome to church. When you can't find a seat, but stay standing. We're going to praise and worship our amazing God this morning, hey? So come on, let's have some fun. We're stripping it back a bit. Hey! Come on, we sing just one word.
Just one word, you calm the storm that's around me. With just one word, the darkness has to retreat. In just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Oh, just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe.
Come on.
There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do.
Just one word.
Oh, just one word. You heal what's broken inside. In just one word, and you revive every dream. Oh, in just one touch, in just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. In just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do.
Come on, we sing. I will believe.
Now we'll believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Now we'll believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Now we'll believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. So praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do.
I will.
So I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Now we'll believe for greater things. There's no power like the power
power like the power of Jesus. Come on, why don't we lift up a shout of praise to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords this morning. Come on.
So why? do I worry? Why do I worry? Why do I worry? God knows.
Come on, church, full of faith. Sing it out. Come on, why do I worry?
So why do I worry? Why do I worry? Why do I worry? God knows what I need. Oh, why do I worry? Yes, why do I worry? Why do I worry? God knows what I need. So I'll give thanks to God, 'cause he don't have enough, and he's more than enough. He's more than enough, and he knows what I need. So I'll give thanks to God when I don't have enough, 'cause he's more than enough, and he knows what I need. Yes, you know.
Colossians 3:1 says these words: since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth, church. For you died to this life, and your new life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, is revealed to the whole world, you will share in all his glory. Church, we have a moment where we forget the temporal and we fix our eyes on the eternal, where our hope lies, where our future is. It's not in these things that are fading and will fall away and are gone tomorrow. It is in our God, it is in our Savior, it is in Jesus Christ himself. And I don't know about you, but I didn't come to do a church service this morning and tick it off the list. I didn't walk in this place to go through the motions and walk back out the door unchanged with a mindset that is still exactly the same. I came this morning to meet with my Creator, Jesus Christ, because he's in here, he's in the moment, he's right here. And he wants to meet with you and me. It's not found in the hype. It's not found in the noise. It's found in a heart that is open and just says, God, why do I worry? Change it. God, why do I worry about the temporal? Change it. Fix my eyes on the eternal. So let's sing one more time with our arms wide, with our hearts open, and with our eyes fixed on the realities of heaven. Come on, church.
More than enough.
when I don't have enough, 'cause he's more than enough, and he knows what I need, so I'll give thanks to God.
God, we give you praise this morning. We give you all the adoration. We take our eyes off the temporal, God, and we fix our eyes on the eternal, because you're worthy. And everyone said, amen. Hey, church, it's so good to be with you. My name's Simon. If we haven't met before, I'd love to say hello, love to shake your hand, maybe over coffee, if that's your choice of beverage. But hey, I'm just so glad to be in the house this morning. And even as I was just thinking about church this morning, I was so excited, one, to gather, but most importantly, to meet with Jesus. That's what we've come here to do. And so I'm excited for that. And so with that, why don't you just grab your seats? We've got a whole load of announcements that I'm going to kick through and try and make sure that you remember them, but that I remember them. So bear with us this morning. And we're going to start with a short video. So if you could turn your eyes to the screen, and we'll go from there.
Run to the Father, fall in the grace. I'm done with the hiding, the reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again.
So good, hey? We've got baptisms coming up, church. 17th of January, they're coming up. So expression of interest is out now. If you haven't been baptized, what a way to start the year, hey? 2021, consumed by Jesus, public declaration, 17th of January, that's for you. But that's where this announcement just gets bigger and bigger, because we're actually going to join with 6O. They're coming back from summer camp, and they're going to be joining us on the 17th for our baptism service. Yeah? They're coming straight off a conference, a camp together, where they're going to join with us. They're going to have met with Jesus, so you better make sure that on the 17th we've done the same, because they're going to bring it that day. But also, they're looking for volunteers. And so if you're interested and you can give some time over summer camp, please go to the info desk, get some more info there. But they're really looking for a breakfast team and some more security. So if that's you, please make sure you contribute and give back to the next generation. And that ties in all with, in January, we're doing a refresh reset. I don't know about you, but this year has been pretty crazy. Lots of changes, lots of stuff going on. And so what a moment in January, after the Christmas season, where we remember Jesus, we celebrate his birth, we're then able to step into January and just really refresh as a church, reset as a church, refocus, and go about the new year in 2021. So we got a lot of exciting things coming up. And so hopefully you've remembered those. If you've forgotten them, like I already have, we can go to the iDesk together afterwards and we can find out all that information together. But what we are going to do is we're going to give our tithes and offerings this morning. And so if this is your first time in church, feel free, no under obligation to give this morning. I want to make sure that you're a visitor in this place, you're new to this place. This is something that we do as a local church. But I was just thinking about giving. And if you do need a credit card slip, feel free to grab one off us and we'll get it to you. Just raise your hands in the air. But I got the opportunity yesterday just to head down to Dream Builders Care, where we were packing hampers, and my youngest is 3, nearly 4. And we got to run around with the Dream Builders Care team and just pack hampers for the community, and to be able to give back. And I thought, what an amazing job the care center did in being able to host us and allow us into that space to be able to pack those hampers. But what blew me away even more so was that just the generosity 350 or something crazy hampers that we're able to give back to our community. And that's because we give as a local church, we tithe, we give to something that's bigger than us. And it blessed me, and I'm not even receiving one, because I said to Sully at the end of it, my son, I said, "What did you think about that?" And he said, "That was so much fun." And as a dad, I was like, I don't need to do anything else today. I think I've won. The fact that he's thinking of others at Christmas time, whether he remembers it or not, I feel like it's sowing a seed. And so I want to say, church, thank you for giving. Thank you for giving, because it allows me to be able to sow in generosity into my son. And I thought, what a privilege it is to be a part of this church community. Hey, so, so good. So with that, I'm going to pray for our offering. We're not going to collect it up. If you do need to give, service host will be at the auditorium at the end, and we'll be able to collect those as you walk past. But let's pray, hey? Dear God, thank you so much for the opportunity that it is to give, and the fact that you've given your son. And from that, God, we've got all that we need. But God, I thank you that you challenge us to generosity. You challenge us to sow. You challenge us to give of our finances. And so, God, with that, I pray whatever's taken up this morning, you would take, you would multiply, and you would grow, and you would do what you need to do with it. But also, too, God, I pray these hampers that are going forth, they would be more than a hamper this season. They'd be an invitation to meet with you. And I pray that salvation would come of those hampers that step into people's homes. So with that, God, we praise you, we glorify, and we thank you so much. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. So good. We're going to continue to worship with the team. And if you are here and you're a young person, feel free to race out to DBK, and you can join in the service out there as well. But let's stand and worship.
This world sin next in like a candle to the sun, an unfailing Father will compass to his great love. Behold his soul. Forsaken for the sake of all mankind, salvation is in his blood. Jesus Messiah, the righteous died for love. But it wasn't over, for he is the risen one. Then sings my soul. Then sings my soul. How great your love is. Sings my soul, then sings my soul. sings my soul. Truth when I can't find it. Light up this broken heart and light my way till my time on earth is done. And oh, Holy Spirit, breathe in me like kingdom. Let your work in me be done. Oh, then sings my soul. And then sings my soul. And how great your love is. Yes, Lord. And how
there's no one like you, Jesus. No one like you, Jesus. Oh, we've come, we've come, we've come to worship you. The only reason, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, we've come, we've come, we've come to worship you. There's no one like you, Jesus. No one like you, Jesus. Oh, we've come, we've come, we've come to worship you. The only reason, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, we've come, we've come, we've come to worship you. There's no one like you, Jesus. No one like you, Jesus. Oh, we've come, we've come, we've come to worship you. The only reason, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, we've come, we've come, we've come to worship you.
anyone else. It's only you, it's only you. And every creature of the earth and sky, under seas and over mountains high, every facet of creation cried, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. And every living thing before the throne, all the wonders that the heavens hold, and for eternity the song echoes, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb.
Seated on high, beauty and majesty, there is no one like you. Be glorified, exalted above all things. There is no beside you.
And only you would lead the halls of grace. No. Only love could bear that kind of pain. Worthy is the Lamb, oh, worthy is the Lamb. And only you could overcome the grave, knowing that a greater joy awaits when I stand to face. Oh, worthy is the Lamb. Oh, worthy is the Lamb. Seated on high, beauty and majesty. 'Cause there is no one like you. Be glorified, exalted above all things, 'cause there is none beside you. Seated on high, beauty and majesty, 'cause there is no one like you. Be glorified, exalted above all things, 'cause there is none beside you. Heaven is resounding, angels all around sing, holy, you are holy. Standing in your glory, my heart can't help but join in. Holy, you are holy. Resounding, angels all around sing, holy. angels all around sing, holy, you are holy. Oh, standing in your glory, my heart can't help but join in. Holy, you are holy. And holy, you are holy. I pray today that you would recenter us, refocus us on Jesus and Jesus alone. That you're our all sufficiency. I pray, Lord, that we have any other treasures in our heart that would supersede you or take your place, or things that you've been speaking to us about to say, hey, that's in the way, that's an obstacle. Lord, I pray those things would fall to the ground. They're not as important as you. Lord, I just pray for people who need some freedom right now from that. I just pray for freedom in the name of Jesus. I just feel like the word of the Lord is just drop it at the foot of the cross. It's not as important as you think it is. Hallelujah. Right now. Lord, I just thank you for a release of the grace of Jesus. I just feel right now that for some of you who are dropping those things, you're going to feel a new grace and a new response of his presence in your life. Hallelujah, right now. Hallelujah. And I just feel like the Holy Spirit's saying, but some of you actually, instead of dropping something at the foot of the cross, you need to take up something that God's asked you to pick up. Remember, his yoke is easy, his burden is light. But he's asking you to pick it up. Hallelujah. I just pray for wisdom and for strength in Jesus' name for your people. Lord, I pray for people right now whose family members are far from you, prodigal sons. I just pray they'd come back in Jesus' name. Lord, people who've been praying for their loved ones, spouses, children, I believe in the name of Jesus for fresh revelation over this season. That you'd start bothering them, God. Lord, that they're trying to work things out in their own mind, their own strength. But Jesus, I pray that you'd supersede all that. Go right to the heart of the matter. Give them a revelation of Jesus. It's not by might or by power. Some of you have been trying to figure out a way. I just have a sense. Some of you have been trying to figure out a way. How do I convince this person? You can't. I just feel like God's saying, hey, just take that burden off your shoulders. Just begin to pray for them. The Bible says the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and avails much. And we've been made righteous by the blood of Jesus. I pray for, as we saints pray for those ones, Father, I just believe in the change of life through Jesus. And Lord, we just pray for favor in our communities in Jesus' name. Favor for the gospel.
Lord, touch and change our hearts. I just pray that we'd be fully focused on kingdom responsibility. Seek first your kingdom and your righteousness, and you'll take care of all of our needs. I pray for those who've been worrying about their needs, Father, right now. I just pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, take that worry off their shoulders. You are their provider. In Jesus' name, help us, Father. We just fix our eyes on Jesus this morning. You are the reason for the season. Amen. Amen. Awesome. You can take your seats, everybody. Well, that was nice. That was some nice, gentle worship this morning, wasn't it? Nice just being in his presence. Wonderful. Well, who was at the hamper packing yesterday? Who was it? Yeah, awesome. And thank you so much. That was amazing. We just love doing that this year. And, it was just amazing to just, we just want to believe that every time we put something into someone's hands, it's practical. They just have a sense of Jesus with that, you know, because we don't just want to feed them like physically. That's important. But ultimately, we want to show them Jesus, don't we? That's what their real need is. And so we're just thankful for that. And, who can believe Christmas is a few days away? Man, I hope you're making room for all those Christmas feasts you're about to eat. I did a wedding yesterday and I was like, putting on my pants at home, none of my suit pants fitted me. It was very depressing. And I thought, gee, Tim, you're getting quite fat. So, no Christmas feast for me. No, that's not true. I am. I'm going to do it. Just work hard afterwards. But so Christmas is here, nearly here, and I'm really excited about it. Just a reminder, Christmas Eve services this Thursday evening, 6 p.m. here and at our Malaga campus, and whichever campus you go to, just want to remind you, we're one church, and so whichever one you go to is fine, but we just really want to encourage you, let's be in church. Of course, with COVID restrictions, we can only fill this place to 60% capacity, and so I want to encourage you maybe that if you've never been over to Malaga, Jake and Tegan are doing a great job there. And maybe just head over there for Christmas Eve and just be a part of our church there. And you'll be blessed. But that's going to be just an awesome night. Simply Jesus, 6 p.m. We're just going to be focusing on Jesus, what we've been talking about this morning. And I think it's going to be brilliant. And can I just ask this as well, everybody? We've got our Christmas Day banquet through Dream Builders Care. It's a real blessing to people in our community. We are desperately needing more volunteers for that. And so it is Christmas Day in the afternoon. I think you'd have to be there from about 4:30. If you can give any time, you can either go directly. There's a registration on the website that you can do at Dream Builders Care. I don't have that on me off the top of my head, but you can just contact our office and we'll refer you if you would like to do something like that. But yes, we'd love you to get involved that way. Awesome. Well, hey, we're going to focus on Jesus this morning. We've been doing a series called Heaven on Earth. And that sounds like a nice idea, doesn't it? But it's going to be a little bit theological this morning. And so I'd like us to turn to, if you've got your Bibles, the Gospel of Matthew. And we're going to be reading from chapter 1, verse 18, right through to 25. Right through to 25. So Matthew chapter 1, verse 18 to 25. And I think we have that on the screen, do we, guys? We do. Oh, brilliant. Okay. It's from the NLT. It says this. The birth of Jesus the Messiah. This is how Jesus the Messiah was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. But before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Joseph, to whom she was engaged, was a righteous man and did not want to disgrace her publicly. So he decided to break the engagement quietly. As he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. Joseph, son of David, the angel said, "Do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit, and she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, which means the Lord saves." Amen. "For he will save his people from their sins." All this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. "Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She'll give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. Thank you, Lord. When Joseph woke up, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded, and he took Mary as his wife. But he did not have any sexual relations with her until his son was born, or her son was born, and Joseph named him Jesus. That's the Christmas story right there. It's the good news of Jesus. God came down in Jesus to save us from our sins. And it's actually a pretty revolutionary, amazing idea if you've never heard of it before. You know, this week we were just talking staff. One of our staff members, Anna, she's been going into a local primary school and doing a Jesus-themed program with some of the kids there. It's one of the ministries that we've been doing as a church. And that's been really, really powerful. But she just finished up this week. But the very last day that she was actually in the school, she actually talked about the nativity story with the children. And there was quite a number of them, and all except for two who went to a Greek Orthodox church with their family, none of them had ever heard the Christmas story. And I want to tell you, church, that we are living in an age where the generation coming up is totally biblically illiterate. They don't know who God is. They don't know who Jesus is. They have no idea about the Christmas story apart from, you know, maybe an odd mention here or there. And you know, maybe the older generations know about it, but our young people don't. And but as we were hearing that, you know, and as we were talking about that, I was a little bit saddened by it, and maybe we are a little bit saddened by it, but the truth is that it actually presents us with a wonderful opportunity as the church, because we've got a whole new generation coming up with a blank slate. They got a blank canvas. They're not offended or hurt by the church. You see, I don't think many people actually have a problem with Jesus. Everybody that I meet that has a problem has usually been offended by the church. Has anyone found that to be true? People don't need the church per se. I love the church. I'm a pastor of a church. I love the Church of Jesus Christ. But we can all admit the church is pretty messed up, right? It's both wonderful and just a total mess at the same time. That's okay. It's filled with us. It's filled with people. Isn't that your life in summed up? Yet things are going well and yet quite messy. And well, that's my life anyway. And, you know, I need Jesus. We all need Jesus. And people don't need that. They need Jesus. They don't need an institution. They don't need religion. They need Jesus. And so, can I encourage us that we've got a whole new generation coming through, that it's a blank slate. We get to represent Jesus to them. And can I say to us, let's not stuff it up. Because we have in previous generations. We've got a new opportunity. I think whenever something bad happens, you know, Mel's preaching this morning Malaga, and the theme of her message is God's greatest gifts come in ugly packages. Has anyone found that to be true, that often God blesses us with things in life, but we don't like the packaging? You know, when we go through suffering, it's often the time that if we respond to it well, we grow the most. It's an ugly packaging. We don't want it, but the gift that you end up with is quite nice. More Christ-likeness. And so God knows best, of course. He's a good father. And so we've got a new generation. And, you know, I was just thinking, man, as the church, what an opportunity we have over Christmas. But just any time to start having this new perspective that we are growing up in a place, we are maturing in a place where people don't know Jesus, and we've got a brand new opportunity to show a church that loves one another, because Jesus said, if you love one another, then people will know you're what? My disciples. So no more fighting, no more disagreeing with the church down the road. Man, God must be so sick of all that nonsense. And the problem is, do we know Jesus enough to show him off properly? And, you know, I was with, I've been doing some business coaching, and I was, one of the guys who's been doing this with me, he took me to meet Jerry Hansen this week from Hansen Construction. I was sitting there with Jerry, and he's an interesting guy. But, you know, Jerry has a program within his workplace that he hires guys out of prison and gives them a second chance. And as we're walking through his workshops, he's sort of telling me, like, I give people second chances. As I'm looking at this culture that he's creating, I felt really envious. And I was like, man, this is what he's doing is what churches should be doing. And we are doing some of that. And so, and I don't think one single church can do everything. You can't be effective and do everything. You've got to focus on a few things and do them well. Otherwise, you're not going to do anything well. But the church, I just mean collectively, it kind of made me jealous. And it should make us jealous, everybody, where we say, what am I doing? Not what the church is doing. We are the church. The church is doing lots of things corporately, but I think the question we should ask ourselves is, what am I doing? What am I doing? And I think the Christmas story, this story right here, should spark in us a desire for kingdom deployment, where each and every one of us is called into the place and space where God says, I want to use you to expand my kingdom. I want to see, and I know we all want to see, we want to see heaven on earth. Amen. The traditional Christmas, the traditional Christian idea is that as Christians, we want to get away from this yucky, gross earth and be transported up to paradise up there. That is a philosopher's idea from the 18th century. It's not really what the Bible teaches. The Bible doesn't frame this earth as yucky and nasty. In fact, can I tell you, our future is right here. New heavens, new earth. And listen, when we die before Jesus returns, we go to be with the Father, there's no doubt. But the future of our great hope is here on earth, new heavens, new earth. The whole idea from the very beginning was heaven and earth coming together. If you think about heaven, it's God's space, that idea. That's what the Bible talks about. God's space and earth is our space. And the whole idea of Eden was that God's space and our space came together. Heaven and earth coming together, and God would walk in the cool of the evening with his people in the garden. That was the whole idea. God was creating humanity to be with us, to be Emmanuel, God with us. That was the whole intention. Heaven on earth. God always planned to dwell amongst his people. And listen, I think the really good news of Christmas is summed up in this one verse, Matthew 1:21. And she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus. That means the Lord saves, for he will save his people from their sins. You know, the good news is often framed like this. Human beings have sinned. God came through Jesus to take our punishment on the cross, forgive our sins through the cross. And listen, that is certainly true. That is a big part of the gospel. But we have to ask, what does the Bible mean about what does the cross mean? And what does it mean that Jesus came to save his people from their sins? What does that mean? Well, I think within philosophy, we've come to view sin in a certain way, especially biblically. And the problem is, I think, that oftentimes we view sin through a biblical lens and we view ourselves as human beings as simply moral machines. You know, we look at God, and that's what most people think about God in our community, is like God's up there with a big stick saying, will you do the right thing or will you do the wrong thing? And when you do the wrong thing, I'm going to give you a smack. God's only interested in our morality. But the Bible frames humanity and human beings so much larger than that. We're not just moral robots. That's more to humanity than that. That God has created us actually to worship and to celebrate and to procreate and to take on various responsibilities within his creation. The picture that Genesis gives of humanity is so much larger than us doing the right or the wrong thing. That is certain. Morality is important. Don't get me wrong. It's very important, but it's not the only thing. God's created humanity to be so much wider and broader than that. And yet so often, I don't know about you, but we can tend to think of ourselves as just simply moral machines. God came and died for my sins, and that was the most important thing. It's certainly a part of it. But I think if we can shift our focus a little bit and say, actually, sin is a problem, but is a symptom of a larger issue. When God created us, what did he create us as? He said, I will make man in my image. God has created us as human beings to be image bearers. It's a vocation, if you like. It's a vocation where we bear the image of the Creator and we are in the world to not only worship him, but to reflect back the praises of creation onto our Creator in the way that we worship, celebrate, procreate, take up responsibilities in the world that he gives us. This is the picture that Genesis gives us. It's not simply a matter of right or wrong, though that is important. Please hear me when I say that. But it is a larger picture. And God created us to be image bearers. It's a vocation that he gave us. Human beings aren't just made to keep rules. It's more than that. And listen, here's the thing. The story of Genesis is about humanity turning away from our original vocation. We gave up the rights and responsibilities and privileges of image bearing to not worship the Creator, but to worship the created. And sin is a human failure of vocation. When we sin, we're actually abusing our calling, our privileges, our possibilities as human beings by stepping away from that original vocation when God said, I reserve the right to know what's best. And as humanity, we said, no, we trust our own wisdom to know what is best. Listen, Jesus' life and death, it does rescue us from hell. It does bring us back into relationship with God, but it also brings us back predominantly to that Genesis chapter 1, 2, and 3 story of restoring our original vocation. God always wanted to be amongst his people, heaven and earth coming together. And what does the Bible say? That in the Messiah, God has brought together heaven, God's space, and earth, our space, once again. I want us to think about this. He does this through a rescue. It's really interesting, if you think about it, that Jesus died on the cross at Passover. The traditional way that we've thought about the cross is one of atonement, and that is true. There are themes of atonement in the cross. That is definitely true. God does atone for us. And yet, if Jesus predominantly had wanted to get that message across, he could have gone to Jerusalem at the Feast of Atonement. He does not. He goes to Jerusalem at the time of Passover. What is Passover? It's a microcosm of a larger theme. Here's the theme that you get in the Old Testament. God brings together heaven, his space, and earth, our space, together in Eden. And his plan is for him to dwell amongst his people, for us to be image bearers, worshiping him and reflecting the praises of creation back to him through the way that we live. That's God's plan. But when we handed back that vocation of image bearing and sin led to death, we actually pushed ourselves away from God's presence. God's original plan of heaven and earth coming together, we push that away because we were in a place of exile. Think about this theme. Adam and Eve sin, they are exiled out of the garden. God was walking amongst his people in Eden, they sin, they're exiled out of the garden. Then the people of Israel are slaves in Egypt. They're exiled out of God's presence. They don't know God, they're not with him. And then God comes through at Passover, He pays the price for sins, that whole image of the blood on the doorposts as the people of Israel are waiting for the angel of death to pass over. As he sees the blood, he passes over. Sins are forgiven. And then God comes and rescues his people out of exile, separation from his presence. And he brings them into the promised land where in the temple, he now dwells among his people. Heaven and earth coming together. Exile, sins are forgiven. Rescue out of exile, God's presence, heaven and earth coming together. Does that make sense? God is patient with his people, and yet they continue to reject and reject and reject him until finally they go off into exile again, this time in Babylon. And we get an image in Ezekiel of the presence of God that has been dwelling in the temple. It lifts off and it goes away. A picture of God's people, not just physically going into exile, but going into exile from the presence of God, heaven and earth separating. And then what happens? God rescues his people after enough time has gone by and he brings them back from exile, and yet the presence of God, nowhere in the Old Testament do we get a picture of the presence of God coming back and being on the temple again. And for Old Testament Jewish people, they, even though they had come back to Jerusalem, they knew the presence had not come back to the temple, and in some ways they still see themselves, even today, in exile because they are waiting for heaven and earth to come together again. They're waiting for God to rescue them out of exile. That's the theme and the pattern of the Old Testament scriptures. God longs for his space and our space to be together. And the choice we make to worship the created separates us from his space. So in a sense, all humanity in the garden was separated from the presence of God. We'd gone out into exile. And this pattern continues. You know, we are living in a world today, not just where our young people don't know about Jesus, but people are seeking, they are seeking all sorts of different things in creation to fulfill that emptiness and that longing that they feel for God's presence. That's what they want. Internally, we all want heaven on earth together. We're created for that. We're designed for that. We're missing our original vocation and people don't understand it. And they're looking everywhere else except the presence of God. They want the kingdom, but they don't want the king. And so they're trying to fill their life. And this is where sin is so dangerous, because sin is simply those things where we are trying to grasp onto and know better than God and say, this will fill up my need, because we have a vocation and we've left it behind and we live in sin. And just like the Old Testament pattern, we are exiled from the presence of God. And so we need God, as is the pattern of the Old Testament, to come through and rescue us. Jesus saves. The Lord saves and restore us to heaven and earth together. So what then is Passover? It is where God himself comes down. He forgives the sin of his people. This is the pattern. He rescues them out of exile and he dwells among them again with his presence. Why does Jesus die at Passover? It is God himself coming down to forgive the sins of his people. He rescues us out of exile and he brings together in the Messiah heaven and earth together so that God can once again dwell amongst his people with his presence. We've been forgiven. He's brought heaven and earth together. He is restoring. That's what the kingdom is all about. As the kingdom spreads, God is restoring his original vocation and intention to humanity. When you know Christ, it's not simply about having sins forgiven. I'm a moral person. It's about God restoring to you your original vocation, that I'm an image bearer, that I was created to celebrate and worship him and reflect praises back to him and celebrate the fact that in him, heaven and earth are together. God's space and our space are being brought together. It's happening right now amongst God's people, and it's not fully completed yet, but one day it will be. We live in a time of the here and the not yet. And this is the good news of Christmas. Emmanuel, God with us. It's a larger picture that God comes, he saves his people from their sins, he restores to them their original vocation. He rescues us out of exile from his presence and he brings us close, God's space and our space, together once more. And that peace and that beautiful picture is what our world needs so deeply, so longingly. And that's why the Bible says we are jars of clay, but we contain a treasure. This is the good news that we must preach, everybody. Jesus, the Lord who saves, comes and rescues his people from their sins. And you have people in your world and in my world and in our community who desperately need the gospel. What are we doing? Oh, but the church, no, you, me. What is God doing in and through us? And this is Jesus said, this is how you will know, they will know that you are my disciples by the way that you love one another. We get to represent this in a whole new way to the community around us. Can I encourage you, implore you, exhort you as a spiritual father, as it were, that let's allow the maturity of Christ to flow through us, the love of Jesus to flow through us. This is not the time for playing games or for mucking around or for living a mediocre life, that Christ has called us to live out the fullness of our original intention and vocation. And as we do that, the glory of God is shone to all around us. Christmas is simply a microcosm of this picture, that Jesus came, as the angel said to Joseph, the Lord saves and he will save his people from their sins. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much that you came as good news. The good news is that you're rescuing your people out of exile from your presence. You have forgiven our sins, and so we can return to our original vocation and our place. You've brought together heaven and earth. God's space and our space back together. Jesus Emmanuel, God with us. And Lord, I just pray over this Christmas time as churches right across Perth are celebrating the reason for the season. I am believing for so many people to come to know you. I pray in Jesus' name for your kingdom to come on earth as it is in heaven, your will to be done, for transformation and for change in our communities, for transformation and change amongst us. Lord, that we decide right now to step into that original vocation in all its fullness as image bearers, living with our sins forgiven. It's all about you, Jesus, what you have done. It's what you have done. You came, you rescued, you forgave, you brought heaven and earth together, God's space, our space, and we're now no longer in exile. Lord, help us to tell, help us to show, help us to live this out. Father, I just pray that you would strengthen us, give us wisdom, knowledge, and strength and anointing to be able to live that out amongst our families, communities, workplaces. God, we take up what you're asking us to do. I pray that we would, in this time, step out each individually into kingdom deployment to see ourselves as missionaries in our space. I pray you'd be speaking to people right now, Holy Spirit. Challenge us. Change us, transform us. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray these things. Amen.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Tim. Really appreciate it. Hey, thank you so much for joining us online. Thank you for joining us in the house this morning. Just three really quick things. The Christmas banquet is coming up at Dream Builders Care. All of these announcements can be found, more info at the iDesk. We've also got Christmas Eve service in-house, online, Malaga. Feel free to join us in one of those spaces. And the 27th of December is an all-in service family, so no DBK. There still is Little Dreamers. But I want to say thank you so much for joining us this morning, and let's go out singing with the team.
I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. And I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. And I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. So praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a thing that our God can't do. Oh, we lift up your name. Oh, we sing praises to you, Jesus.
Have a great week, church. Be blessed.